The president. Mr. Kenneth Leung, Mr. President, as the chairman of the Bills Committee on Inland Revenue Amendment Tax Concessions Bill 2019, I would like to report to the Legislative Council the deliberation of the Bills Committee. The bill seeks to give effect to a tax concession proposal in the 2019-2022 budget to reduce salaries tax, tax on the personal assessment, and profits tax for the year of assessment 2018-2019 by 75%, subject to a ceiling of $20,000 per case. The Bills Committee held one meeting to discuss the bill with the administration. As a two-tiered profits tax rate regime has been introduced for corporations and unincorporated businesses starting from the year of assessment 2018-2019 to reduce the tax burden of such entities, some members queried whether it was still necessary to offer a one-off reduction of tax to such corporations and unincorporated businesses. Some members observed that some individuals or enterprises might have paid tax in previous years of assessment, but then as a result of reduced income or sustaining losses and thus not chargeable to tax in the year of assessment 2018-2019 and are therefore not benefiting from this tax concession. Therefore, some Bills Committee members asked whether we could make use of other formulas of calculation so as to provide the same one-off tax rebates to them. Say, for example, having the one-off tax rebate calculated with reference to the amount of sales tax, tax under personal assessment or profits tax for the previous year of assessment, or allowing losses made in an accounting year to be carried backward for setting off against the assessable profits. The administration has explained the difficulties to implement the above suggestions, taking into account fiscal management principles and the narrow tax base of Hong Kong. Besides, given that reductions for sales tax, tax under personal assessment, and profits tax have been provided in every year of assessment since year assessment 2011 to 2012, allowing one-off tax rebate calculated with reference to the amount of the tax paid for the previous year of assessment or years of assessment may result in double deductions of tax for a year of assessment and thus distort the basis of tax assessment. As regards the treatment of losses in relation to profits tax, the administration has pointed out that the Inland Revenue Ordinance, Cap 112, already allows losses of enterprises of a year of assessment to be carried forward without time limit for setting off against assessable profits derived in the subsequent year of assessment. Allowing losses made in a year of assessment to be carried backward for setting off against assessable profits in the back years may result in tax refund at any time and cause drastic and unpredictable fluctuations in tax revenue. In addition, some members have asked the administration to introduce more concessionary measures to provide more assistance to the needy in the financial year 2019-2020 and its budget. The administration has pointed out that for the 2019-2020 budget, resources have already been allocated to support local enterprises, including measures to help enterprises expand Hong Kong's market coverage or resolving liquidity problems. Various types of financial relief measures are also offered to needy families, such as providing extra allowance to recipients of working family allowance and CSSA. The Bills Committee has not proposed any amendments, and the Bills Committee has no objection to the resumption of the second reading debate on the bill. According to the notice given by the administration, the bill was supposed to have its second reading debate resumed at the legislative meeting held on the 26th of June 2019. However, at the close of the session 2018-2019, this was not dealt with, and therefore it has been stood over till today. In between, on the 15th of August 2019, the Financial Secretary made an announcement setting out a number of measures, including the following. That is, the one-off tax rebate will be adjusted from 75% as suggested in the bill to 100% in relation to sales tax, tax under personal assessment and profits tax for the year of assessment 2018-2019, subject to a ceiling of $20,000 per case. In order to implement the further tax concession, the administration has already proposed amendments. The Bills Committee earlier on, by way of circulation, considered the information note submitted by the administration and we've invited written comments from members. Well, prior to the expiry of the specified deadline, members have not proposed any objection to the amendments. Mr. President, I would like to move on to my personal views regarding the bill. President, for the years 2018 and 2019, the administration presented a lot of amendments to the Inland Revenue Ordinance. Of course, a lot of them were in relation to the requirements of the OECD's requests or international standards. Some of the Inland Revenue proposals have been introduced for the sake of our businesses so as to provide some tax incentives for certain sectors or industries. Well, on a yearly basis for such measures, whether we're talking about tax concessions or tax incentives for different industries or sectors, we can see for ourselves that usually the administration has merely adopted a piecemeal approach. We don't have a comprehensive response in terms of revenue to the prevailing business environment. The year before last, the FS proposed the setting up of a group to deal with tax measures, with the tax policy unit being set up under the Financial Secretary's office. Well, I think the tax policy unit has only got limited resources, so it cannot be very effective. But still, I would like to remind the FS, other than the tax policy unit under the FSO, we have also got a taxation liaison committee, which has been in operation for over 20 years. And in fact, it has got stakeholders with 20, 30 years of experience in terms of such taxation matters. And then regarding the guidelines issued by the Inland Revenue Department, we have been providing very constructive input. So I hope that the tax policy unit should operate in such a way that they coordinate and cooperate with the Taxation Liaison Committee. You may very well set aside a lot of resources for the unit to recruit a lot of talents, but they can in no way substitute the members who assist the administration as members of the Taxation Liaison Committee for no remuneration at all. So please make sure that the two will work hand in hand, and it will be a very optimal use of your available resources. Of course, for the current year of assessment, the administration is going to provide a large number of taxation measures, one being the leasing business in the maritime sector. And then I understand that there is one such element in the document, and that's about the shipping register. I am afraid it isn't too helpful. It is said that the number of vessels registered, it has increased from 2,448 to 2,613 between the years 2015 and 2019, an increase of 6.7%. We may think that it is an annual rate of increase, but in fact, this is not the case. In fact, our shipping register has lagged behind that of Singapore and many other countries. We may very well claim ourselves to be the fourth largest shipping register in Hong Kong in the world, but we should aim our eyes at becoming the first and the most important shipping register in the world. So we look forward to the presentation of that bill to the Legislative Council as soon as possible. And then I would like to talk about some structural issues, but we don't have the chance to look at them or to have a discussion of that, because usually we are told that as a result of the reverse in the economic cycles, or because there is a particular need for a particular sector, we need to come up with certain measures. Well, in fact, we have positioned ourselves as a holding center for intellectual property. But then for our taxation measures, I'm afraid for years we are not living up to such a reputation or such a positioning in terms of our economic development. Well, many enterprises choose not to come to Hong Kong because when it comes to taxation matters for IP rights, we are lagging behind. There are two issues involved. I hope the government will spend time and efforts on it. You can ask the tax policy unit to study this matter. First of all, in terms of intellectual property rights, yes, we have agreements to avoid double taxation with many places. We have to find out whether it is providing the best incentives when compared with other counterparts. We have already signed over 40 CDTAs to avoid double taxation. And then in terms of our taxation infrastructure, well, I think our own IRO is such that in relation to the taxation of IPR-related profits, I think I've been told by many enterprises that in many cases, well, we are supposed to be a holding center of the IPRs. In many cases, we issue a license to allow a company to have exclusive right to use the intellectual property. And then the holder of such a license doesn't have to do anything. It can, by way of a sublicense, allow the IPR to be used by an end user. It is a common arrangement as to why people would like to resort to Hong Kong as the holding center of IPRs. However, whether we have agreements to avoid double taxation or not, end users of such IPRs, say for example for the royalties, well, the end user would pay royalties to the licensee of the IPR, and then the licensee would further submit the royalties to the company in Hong Kong. But then as a result of the problems of our taxation policy in Hong Kong, this payment is subject to multiple taxation, and it cannot be exempted from the CDTAs, which aim at avoiding double taxation. I don't want to go into the details because it is rather complicated, but I just want to say that many professionals and many chambers of commerce have raised this issue with me for a few years already, but then we never get a chance to raise this issue with the authority. Now, for the year 2019-2020, probably we aren't seeing too many amendment exercises in relation to the IRO. So perhaps it's high time for you to re-examine this part of the IRO. I know that for the IRD, in relation to tax evasion and tax avoidance, you do hold a very serious view. But at the same time, I think the IRD should provide a more facilitating environment so that we can have more business for the holding centers of IPRs, and as a result, and in turn, will get more tax revenue by way of profits tax. So I think it's high time for the government to take this matter seriously. So I speak, Mr. President. I see no reason we should object to this amendment bill. I hope that the bill will be enacted as soon as possible. Thank you.
Mr. Ronick Chan. President, the Inner Revenue Amendment Tax Concessions Bill 2019 has the purpose of putting into effect proposals in the 2019-2020 budget. This is to relieve the burden of taxpayers, and specifically, there will be a one-off reduction of salaries tax, tax under personal assessment, and profits tax for the year of assessment 2018-2019 by 75%, subject to a ceiling of $20,000 per case. As Mr. Kenneth Leung said, there would be further amendments, and I won't repeat what he said. After enactment of this bill, the reduction will be factored into the final tax to be paid for 2019-2020. 1.91 million taxpayers of salaries tax and tax under personal assessment and 145,000 taxpaying corporations and unincorporated businesses will benefit. And the revenue forgone would amount to $18.9 billion, in which $17 billion for salaries tax and tax under personal assessment and $1.9 billion for profits tax. According to information from the FST Bureau, from 2017 to 2018, tax from salaries tax amounted to $60.8 billion, and that from tax under personal assessment, $5.3 billion, and that from profits tax, $139 billion. If we use that as a basis, then in terms of tax under personal assessment, it is $17 billion, and compared to $61.6 billion last year, the reduction rate is 26%. Because then we did not separate salaries tax and tax under personal assessment, so I could not really calculate the breakdown of such. And with regard to taxpaying corporations and unincorporated businesses, the reduction would amount to $1.9 billion compared to the revenue, which was over $17 billion. The reduction was only 1.4%. In other words, the reduction this time around really favors the individual and SMEs, because SMEs usually are owned by one to two proprietors, meaning that the reductions would then benefit about 2 million individuals. We do support the overall principle and the direction, and I will support the bill. However, Mr. President, the Hong Kong economy is facing pressure from both within and without, and it is going down a downward trend. I believe that with the passing of the bill, there will be relief to taxpayers to a certain extent. I was not a member of the Bills Committee, but I have read the discussion papers of the committee, and I could see that some members mentioned that there was the two-year profits tax raise regime starting from the year of assessment 2018-2019, and they questioned whether it was still necessary to provide one-off tax reduction in profits tax to such corporations and unincorporated businesses, because if they are paying tax, it means they are making profits. However, there are SMEs which are not making profits or which are actually sustaining losses, and these do not stand to benefit, and they say it might not be fair. By the same token, some members have said that some individuals might have seen a reduced income in this year, or in fact they did not have any income at all, so they would not have to pay salaries tax or tax under personal assessment in this year of assessment, and these people do not stand to gain either. Therefore, they explored with the administration whether there could also be other kinds of relief for such individuals or corporations. As I said, the relief measures were proposed by making reference to the paying of salaries tax, tax under personal assessment, and profits tax in previous years, and an average was taken. And there is a ceiling of $20,000 per case. And also, the tax-paying corporations and unincorporated businesses are allowed to carry forward their losses to future years so that they can have that set against the assessable profit they have to pay. Just now, Mr. Leung said that the administration said these two would be difficult, and it is because there is consideration of the fiscal management principles and also that we have a narrow tax base. Please pay particular attention to this notion of narrow tax base. Actually, starting from 2011-2012, every year, with regard to salaries tax, tax under personal assessment, and profits tax, there has always been tax reduction for such types of taxes. If we calculate the one-off tax rebate on the basis of the average tax based, and then there might be the scenario of double deduction for a particular year of assessment. As for losses in relation to profits tax, again, the administration said that losses of enterprises of a year of assessment can be carried forward without time limit, and so they do not have to consider a particular year. If losses of a certain year is allowed to carry backward to set off against assessable profit of tax-paying corporations, then it is possible that certain tax revenue that has already been put into the government coffers and accounts would lead to sudden fluctuations in tax income. And it is said that in 2019-2020 budget, there are already special measures to support local enterprises, including helping them expand Hong Kong's market coverage. And also under the SME Financing Guarantee Scheme, SMEs have been helped to resolve liquidity problems. In this regard, the FS and the FST Bureau had already announced improvement measures recently, and the Hong Kong Monetary Authority, together with banks, have already set up the SME financing coordination mechanism. I wouldn't go into the details. And also, the administration has also waived business registration fees for 2019-2020, and also the scope and funding of the dedicated funding on branding upgrading and domestic sales have been expanded. So to a certain extent, SMEs have been provided with certain financial relief. But President, whether we are convinced by the administration's explanations, the crux is that we have a narrow tax base. According to predictions, in the 2019-2020 year of assessment, salaries tax, tax under personal assessment, and profits tax is expected to reach $232.3 billion. But of course, given the overall economic assessment, I have certain reservations about the accuracy of such a prediction. With the evolving U.S.-China trade conflict, Hong Kong's economy is slowing down by a large margin, and how we can allow our public finances and economy to continue to develop healthily, I think we all have to pay attention to that. The economic structure in Hong Kong cannot be easily changed. We have a narrow tax base, and we rely a lot for our revenue on land and property. If we rely on the latest information submitted to the Bills Committee in 2017-2018 YA, there were 3.98 million people working in Hong Kong, but only 1.88 million of them pay taxes. In other words, only 53% of our workforce, meaning over half of the workforce, did not have to pay salaries tax or tax under personal assessment. And the administration also said that the first 5% of salaries tax payers accounted for 63% of all salaries tax based. And also from another angle, in the 2017-2018 YA, in Hong Kong, there were 1.27 million corporations and 250,000 unincorporated businesses, but altogether only 132,000 of them have to pay profits tax. In other words, 93% of them do not have to pay profits tax. And then for those that do pay taxes, the first 5% already account for 90% of all profits tax paid. President, there is a high concentration of tax types and taxpayers. I understand it is difficult to find a perfect solution to this in the short term. If we bring in new tax types, then it will have an impact on Hong Kong's attractiveness as a place with a simple tax system. But then, if we continue to have revenue surplus, and at the same time we want to widen the tax base, there would certainly be strong opposition in society. However, I believe you should brace against difficulties and actively think about what tax types can be introduced. Say, for example, some kind of indirect tax that we looked into. And we should also expand the tax base and also the base of taxpayers. And you have to research into whether it is fairer to increase taxes when we have revenue surplus, or whether we should go for it now when the economy is not exactly in a good shape. I think the FSTB and also the FS should really actively look into it. As an international city, Mr. President, Hong Kong must keep abreast of international changes in order to revise our inner revenue laws. At the LegCo here, you can see that we are always given tax related laws to scrutinize. But then we have always been active, proactive, and keeping abreast of the times. And if you look at the UK and Singapore, they have always been active in using taxation as a tool to promote the local economy and also to attract talents from afar. I'd like to emphasize again here that the SARG should actively review the relevant arrangements instead of just following other people's successful examples and experience. If you do that, you will just erode our advantages. At present, we still have the U.S.-China trade dispute not resolved. There are a lot of uncertainties. If it should escalate, then Hong Kong's trade, logistics, and even financial industries may have a relatively high risk of a downward trend, and no one can remain unaffected if that is the overall environment. And no one can say for sure that our handsome surplus will not be depleted if there is a slowing down of the economy. Therefore, when you roll out over $10 billion in tax relief, you should also seek to see how in the long term we can widen the tax base and attract more tax revenue and also attract overseas investors to come to Hong Kong. We should make the best use of our revenue surplus in order to stimulate the economy. That will be the kind of sustainable tax policy we should adopt. Thank you.
Mr. Leng Qichuan. Thank you, Mr. President. In relation to the Inland Revenue Amendment Tax Concessions Bill 2019, I would like to say that I support the bill. According to the economic report issued by the government, starting from the third quarter last year, we have seen a downward trend in relation to our GDP growth, 3.5% in the previous quarter and then 2.9% in the latest quarter. This is all because of the trade war launched by the U.S. government against our country. Tariff rates have been increased substantially, and we are faced with a lot of economic uncertainties. Of course, this is a challenge in relation to our economic prospect. As far as export is concerned, it has been slowing since September last year, with an impact on transport as well as financial services, among other service industries, and their output levels have come down. In fact, in the year 2019, we have seen signs of slowing down. We've only got a 0.6% GDP growth in the first quarter. Our exports have been weakened as a result of the global pessimism, and domestic demand has also come down. For private consumption, overall investment expenditure, among other things, have been eroded, and the labor market has been subject to a lot of pressure. And to aggravate the situation, in June this year, in Hong Kong, we have had 4 months unrest. In addition to the U.S.-China trade war, the tourism industry, catering industry, and the retail industries have been bearing the brunt. There have been a lot of closures, and many people have lost their jobs. So we are being sort of affected by both the domestic environment as well as the external environment. I just wonder if we can still keep the jobless figure at a low level. I'm indeed very pessimistic. In order to ease the burden of the citizens, in order to help the citizens to ride the storm, the government has come up with a one-off tax rebate proposal as part of the budget. And in fact, for sales tax, tax on the personal assessment and profits tax, they're subject to 75% tax rebate up to $20,000 per case. In August this year, the FS came up with a further concession, and the rate of reduction has been enhanced from 75% to 100%. The ceiling is still kept at $20,000 per case. This has my support. Well, capping it at $20,000. Well, for the sandwich class families, as well as the middle class families, it is still very important. Well, for sandwich class households and middle class families, they need tax incentives and tax concessions most, because they don't enjoy a lot of social welfare payments, and yet they have to pay for home mortgage, home loan mortgage, and they have to pay for the educational expenses of the children. There used to be an advertisement saying that it would take you $4 million to raise a child and to meet all the educational as well as other expenses. Well, families would like to give the best education to their children, and they have to pay tax, they have to take out insurance policies. All such would become very heavy financial burdens. So for tax concessions, I think they will help such families a lot. As to the definition of a middle-class family, it means that they have a high level of income, they have some assets, like they own their own properties, they have some savings, they have some investment. And then a former financial secretary used to say that the middle class would enjoy a life of having a cup of coffee and going to the movies. they usually make $25,000 to $50,000 a month. But actually, for such a class, they may not have their own properties. And since they have to spend a lot on household expenditure items, they don't have a lot of savings. And for many of them, they have to cut down on all sorts of expenses because they have to save enough for the down payment of their homes. So tax concessions would be very helpful for the medium household income. In the year 2018, the figure was $28,000 for the middle range. I don't think they have a lot of comfortable margins because it is not easy to pay the price of your property. For a 300 square foot property, the property price would be tantamount to 15 to 16 times the yearly income of such a household. If you earn less than $29,240, you can still try to wait for a proper housing rental unit. But meanwhile, while we're waiting for housing, you have to pay high rentals in the private market. You have to scheme in order to save enough money. So the burden is huge for the administration to provide such a one-off tax rebate. This is to be welcome. However, I think we can do more by way of enhancing the tax allowances. For years, the DAB has already proposed that there should be a tax deduction for employing a domestic helper. And we should also do more to help families who have to take care of young children and elderly family members. Now that we have the opportunities arising from the Greater Bay Area, now, for the, I think if an elderly family member resides at a retirement home in Guangdong, I think we have one such home being subsidized by the SWD in Guangdong, another one in Shaoxing. I think the scheme should be expanded to other cities in the Greater Bay Area as well. Now, for taxpayers, I think the current proposal can offer some help to them. But at the same time, the government shouldn't forget others who are not chargeable to tax. In addition to tax concessions, I look forward to the upcoming budget. I hope that the FS would come up with more relief measures. So hand out more sweeteners. Say, for example, on a one-off basis, give $2,000 to each household to subsidize their electricity bills. And then for the property assistance payment recipients, they should be given 3 times or 4 times the payment. And then PRH tenants should have their rents waived for a couple of months. And then the land rents could also be waived. Now the FS has said that for the low-income families not on CSSA should be given a cash subsidy in the form of a one-off living subsidy under the CCF. I think this is a response to the calls of the DAB. That is, we need to help those who are in nothings. For those living in poor living conditions like the subdivided units, usually they have to pay electricity charges and water charges way above the market or the official rates because they are subject to a different mechanism. I think the government should take out administrative measures to make sure that for such households who are paying for the utility charges as a result of relying on a separate meters will not be subject to abuses. I think we need to help the women to return to the labor force. The DAB has already asked for the retraining causes for them, we need to reconsider the duration, the timing, the subjects, etc. I think we need to have a greater variety of programs and courses. Women should be encouraged to take care of their family while also equipping themselves to prepare for the rejoining of the labor force and release their potential. There are women who have to take care of their children and they have to go to work. For households, having such a problem should be given more help from the government, like grassroots households that have very young children. And if we are talking about a single parent family or double income families, we need to provide more childcare facilities. There is a huge shortage for the neighborhood nanny system. Again, it is not adequate. Many mothers have to stay home to take care of the young children, and so they cannot work because they don't get a place to have their children taken care of at a childcare center. So we need to come up with effective assistance measures before we can deliver on the policies. I think the administration should find ways to encourage and attract more people to join the scheme to provide childcare on a neighborhood basis, like enhancing the honorarium. And then for others who are already joining the scheme, for the single parents, for the grassroots households using such a service, it may become a financial burden to them. I think the government should come up with some financial assistance. Well, given the weakness in the external economic environment, and then there's the likelihood that the U.S. will pass the Hong Kong Human Rights and Democracy Act, I think this is threatening our survival. And I'm afraid this is going to create more uncertainties, causing economic difficulties to us. All the more, we need to integrate with the rest of the Greater Bay Area, and then we need to help young people to look for opportunities on the mainland. I think the government should help the students, especially those who would like to have work experience or study in the Belgian in the Greater Bay Area cities. I think we should provide some subsidies to them. We should also help the enterprises to expand markets beyond Hong Kong. Thank you.
Mr. Wong Ting-kwong. Mr. President, this bill stems from a proposal in the 2019-2020 budget, and that is a one-off reductions of salaries tax, tax under personal assessment, and profits tax for the year of assessment 2018-19 by 75%, subject to a ceiling of $20,000 per case. 2.05 million taxpayers will be benefited, and the proposal will involve an expenditure of $18.9 billion. In the last legislative session, the LegCo already completed scrutiny of the bill. It was supposed to be voted on at the council meeting in June. It wasn't voted on at the meeting, and subsequently the council complex was seriously vandalized, leading to the two subsequent council meetings being cancelled. The bill, therefore, was not voted on before the session ended. With the recent unrest in Hong Kong and rioters causing social unrest, the tourism and hotel industry was severely affected.
This also brings great uncertainty to our local economy. Against this backdrop, the Financial Secretary has adopted a lot of suggestions from the DAB and announced on the 18th of August a further relaxation in relation to the tax further reduction of salaries tax, tax under personal assessment, and profits tax for the year of assessment 2018-2019 by 100%, while retaining the ceiling of $20,000 per case. And taxpayers will have a further saving of $1.84 billion. The proposed amendments to the bill are consistent with the original proposal in the bill. The administration therefore proposed to the president of the council to waive the notice period so that the bill could be dealt with as soon as possible so that taxpayers in Hong Kong will be benefited. Mr. Kenneth Leung, chairman of the bills committee, consulted other BC members whether we could dispense with the notice so that taxpayers could benefit from the tax breaks. Myself and Mr. Kwok Wai Kong, members of the Bills Committee, indicated our agreement to the notice being dispensed with. And finally, the President gave permission to dispense with notice so that we could vote on the bill today. But undoubtedly, a lot of taxpayers will be spared from paying for salaries tax, tax under personal assessment and profits tax. And in the light of the economic uncertainties, a lot of SMEs could receive the assistance they need. They might not be able to make a drastic about turn, but at least they would receive the support they need. And under the bleak social and economic outlook, what we need to do is to stop the violence and restore calmness in society so that we can turn back the dire consequences. Otherwise, even if the administration further proposes other tax reductions in the future, people will continue to suffer. Since June, rioters have been attacking public facilities, government buildings, police stations. They have been battering inbound tourists, journalists. And they're now even assaulting people holding different political views. And they're vandalizing MTR stations, causing a total suspension of the railway lines. They are attacking the Chinese-backed enterprises and banks. And they're vandalizing shops. They're also committing snatching. And the public, there is general panic in the community every weekend. Members of the public are not only in fear of their own safety, they're also in fear of the safety of their property. The business in busy shopping districts such as Causeway Bay and Mong Kok is heavily hampered, as well as F&B, hotel industries, and also transportation. When the blue collar workers rely on to earn a living, they are also affected. According to the gold statistics, for the 1st of October Golden Week, the number of visitors to Hong Kong dropped by 30%. As for mainland visitors, it dropped by 50% compared to the same period last year, and it's record low for the for the past 9 years. As for the major tourist events and sports events, they've been cancelled for the year on year. For retail figures, they have dropped for 7 consecutive months because of frequent unrest. Many restaurants and shops have to remain closed in August, but the total sales volume of the retail industry it stood at 29.4 billion, down by 27%, and on a month, in a single month on a year-on-year basis, this represented the biggest drop. Many employees are forced to take no pay leave, and according to the CNST, the unemployment rate for the catering industry in the third quarter rose to 6%, the highest in the past 6 years. According to the F&B practitioners, this figure has already excluded those casual workers in the industry. And if they're also taken into account, the unemployment rate would be higher than 6%. If social unrest continues, the unemployment rate is expected to climb further. If peace and calm is not restored in Hong Kong, SMEs in various sectors of the community will not be able to survive. Shops and enterprises will close down and workers will be laid off. They won't even have a chance to pay salaries tax or profits tax. So what's the use of having further tax reductions? So the imminent solution for Hong Kong to find a way out is to stop the violence, and that means we should support the police in enforcing the law, and we must get back on the track and restore confidence in SMEs and the general public. This is more beneficial to Hong Kong in general than offering one-off tax reductions. We need joint efforts from various sectors of the community to support the police in enforcing the law. But there are those who do not support the police. For example, LCSD staff members stopped police vehicles from entering the LCSD venues, and we must not accept such acts. Mr. Wong Ting-kwong, please come back to this debate. Well, I'm saying that we must stop the riots and the violence in Hong Kong in order to have economic development. Well, not, and also some political parties in their own interest have continued to spread rumors to prevent the police from taking law enforcement action. Well, the general public is discerning. I think they clearly understand who is acting for the benefit of Hong Kong, and that we must join hands to stop the curb the violence and stop the riot. And for the political parties trying to stir up troubles in Hong Kong, we must be discerning. Finally, I support the bill. And we must support the one-off reductions of salaries tax and tax under PA and profits tax for year 2018-19 by 100% so that we can provide full support for the SMEs. More importantly, I urge the government and the public to support the police in curbing violence and stopping the riot so that peace and calm can be restored in our society, so that we can stop the economic downturn in Hong Kong.
The Honourable Wu Chi-wai.
I heard what Mr. Wang Ting-kwong said. I think it was really an eye-opener. Hong Kong faces the U.S.-China trade dispute and also internal division and confrontation. What Mr. Wang Ting-kwong said did not help us resolve any problem. Let us give this a thought. According to opinion surveys, over half of Hong Kong citizens gave zero mark for governance and zero mark for the police. And then you are telling all government departments to support the police, which should use its force to suppress society. How are we going to resolve problems? Political problems have to be resolved politically. If not, you cannot restore order. On the 9th of June, a million people protested in a peaceful manner, asking the administration to amend its acts. And then what did the DAB say? It said it was to support the voting on the bill on the 12th of June as scheduled. That was the root cause of the entire problem. But you don't face up to it. And then 2 million people requested the administration to respond to five demands. The administration turned a deaf ear to all that. And then, as Mr. Wang Ting-kwong was saying, it still asked people to support the police, which was arbitrary in its arrest and which was using violence against the people. Today, we are debating the Inner Revenue Amendment Tax Concessions Bill 2019. I actually like to ask the administration to look at certain scenarios. Goldman Sachs released a report in October comparing the deposit of Hong Kong and Singaporean residents, and it was said that in October, $30 billion outflew from Hong Kong to Singapore. Well, that might not be anything serious by itself, but if we don't face up to such scenarios and phenomena and seek to know the causes, then we are just burying our head in the sand. Let us look at other figures. US dollar deposits for the same month increased to $130 billion. What does it tell us? Does it mean that Hong Kong people have lost certain confidence in the Hong Kong dollar, so they have switched to US dollar deposits? Have the Hong Kong MA and the FST Bureau done any research into such phenomena? Let us look at offshore accounts, application, and also application for emigration. They are both on the rise. I really like to know how the administration views such phenomena. They tell us that society is voting with their feet about Hong Kong's future. What should we do? How should our governance be? Half of Hong Kong citizens surveyed gave our governance zero mark. The administration is proposing to provide reductions for salaries tax. It's good to give wealth back to the public. I welcome it because I think it's something good. You again further provided more relief by enhancing it to 100%. I still welcome it. But then I must put down a footnote here. We welcomed your previous measures because you gave wealth back to the public so that we could all share in the fruits of our prosperity. But today, people would think that since the government is not to be trusted, it's better to have money in my pocket than in your pocket. At least if money is in my pocket, it will not be used to support the police in its arbitrary arrest, and it would not be buying weapons for the police to hit youngsters on their heads so that they bleed, and also it would not be used to support white elephant projects. If we leave money with the administration and yet it is not put to good use, then perhaps you should do even more to share the money in our coffers with the people. Some people always say that the administration doesn't want to part with its money, but sometimes it just spends the money in the wrong way. The FST Bureau will know this very clearly. We spend $40 billion on the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge, and every year the revenue is just $200 million. And the maintenance cost is $2 billion. Do you call that a successful investment project? What about the XLL? We invested $90 billion in it. What is its revenue like? Is the benefit going to help mainlanders or Hong Kong people? We must respond to all these questions. Yet, when we had special finance committees to scrutinize the budget, the administration will not give us answers. If we leave money with the administration, if the government coffers are flooded with money, and yet you don't face up to problems in our society, we have a housing problem, and you thought of this trick of allowing a higher loan-to-value ratio so people could have their own housing and own it. Well, is it going to be effective, or are you just helping people to launder money or spend money that is not rightfully gained? The FS said on the 15th of August that he would raise the one-off reduction from 75% to 100%. And then he said that such goodies had nothing to do with the anti-extradition bill protest. It was just making preparations for a possible downward trend of our economy. But I'd like to tell the administration, the U.S.-Chinese trade dispute started last year. It has been with us for a long time. Hong Kong should not be caught in the crossroads. We should have an advantage under one country, two systems. Since we have different legal systems between the two places, if we have a high degree of autonomy, if we are captain of our own ship, then we should be able to tell the international community that there is still a line drawn between the mainland and Hong Kong remains a member of the international community. But then the Carrie Lam administration chose to involve ourselves in making comments on certain issues. And she commented in not an appropriate way on the U.S.-China conflict. And also, she proposed the amendments to the Fugitive Offenders Bill, which would open the floodgate of blurring the line between the two legal systems. We should have been careful in not dragging ourselves into the U.S.-China trade conflict so that we will protect ourselves with the one country, two systems, so we would not be drawn into the storm. But then that was not the administration chose to do. Rather, it dragged us into the storm, and then it triggered these 4 months of conflict and confrontation. And then the administration did not take a hard look at why it is not feasible to set up a commission of inquiry. And why is it that when 80% of Hong Kong people told you that that was the consensus of society, yet you would not do it, you would condone the 30,000 strong police to use violence to suppress society? Can you face up to society? Can you face the younger generation? Mr. Wu Chi-wai, please come back to the debate. Yes, I know that, President, but we are talking about amendments to the IRO and whether it is going to be useful and effective. I'd like to point out that the Hong Kong economy may go down a downward trend, and the administration will have to look hard at two factors causing that. One, the U.S.-China trade conflict. Of course, we are passive in this, but then we have to maintain the advantages of our system. I think Mr. Wong Ting-kwong said something right, and that is we should attract more overseas investments to Hong Kong. But then the premise is that we should still enjoy international confidence in the advantages of our system. Otherwise, we'd only be attracting investment from one single source. Secondly, internal conflicts and governance problems. Can the voices of the people be incorporated into the governance of this city? Of course, there are different opinions, but then there is always a mainstream voice. With regard to the evil law of the anti-extradition bill and also this movement, the voice of the public is clear. The absolute majority of Hong Kong citizens feel that the responsibility is on the SARG, that it did not listen to the people, and it did not do what the majority of Hong Kong people expected you to do, for example, by setting up a COI and also responding to the five demands. You did not do that, but you pointed your finger at others. You, as the administration, did something wrong, but you did not face up to it. You laid the blame on others. So the economy may be taking a turn for the worse, but the root cause is with the SARG, and that is why you have the responsibility to respond to the five demands. Otherwise, you will not be able to curb violence and stop the unrest. You may be able to suppress the surface, but then Hong Kong people will resort to other means to play guerrilla warfare with you, or they may boycott you in different ways. Plus, in this tax relief exercise, the young professionals and the middle class should stand to gain the most. But then many opinion surveys have shown that they are exactly the ones who are most unhappy with the governance of this administration. At the same time, they are those who are most capable to make different choices, including emigration. Hong Kong does not have any natural resources. And the people that we treasure, if they choose to emigrate, then I think we are going to face a very difficult situation indeed. And the shadow hanging over us will become even heavier. Therefore, whether it is the tax relief measure of this bill and also the relaxation of the LVR as proposed in the policy address, it is not going to satisfy people because they have other choices. If you want to keep these people in Hong Kong, you have to think carefully how you can retain them in Hong Kong. You may give them one of tax relief or relaxation of the loan-to-value ratio. But then if they knew that our core values have changed, then I think you are too naive to think that you can do so with your one-off reductions. And you just don't know how desperate people are about our future. Our core values are such that the administration follows rules and regulations. We also hope that the administration will listen to the voices of the public, and you should choose your policy tools carefully. When you face political problems, you should show courage and commitment and take political responsibility instead of what you are doing now by laying the blame on other people. You don't seek to resolve problems, but only deal with people who submit problems to you. That goes to tell us that Hong Kong is becoming strange. It is not the Hong Kong that we used to know. I think that is the root cause of the entire problem.
Mr. Kun Xiuping, Mr. President, I speak in support of the Inland Revenue Amendment Tax Concessions Bill 2019, as well as the amendments to be proposed by the administration. The purpose of the bill is as follows: to ease the burden of the taxpayers. This is to give effect to the proposal in the 2019-2020 budget, in particular the tax concessions. This is the one-off tax reduction regarding salaries tax, tax on the personal assessment and profits tax for the year of assessment 2018-2019, subject to a ceiling of $20,000 per case. Later on, the administration would like to further enhance the ratio to 100%. The administration is willing to further enhance the rate of reduction because, according to the government's stance, to help people to deal with the external as well as the domestic challenges, 1.4 million taxpayers will benefit, and we are going to forego $18.9 billion by way of revenue. Well, regarding the tax concession measure, it used to be something that we regularly look for in our budget, and this forms part of the strategy of the government to ease the burden of the people. Regarding the tax concession, as well as the proposed amendment to the bill, as to whether it will be effective in stimulating the economy, enhance social harmony, and giving a buffer to the taxpayers to better take care of their family members. Well, I think the administration has unrealistic expectations. Well, we have deep-seated conflicts in the society. Even with the tax concessions, with the aim to eradicate poverty and to address taxation inequalities, I think there's still room to improve. As to the economic and social conditions in Hong Kong, they have undergone major and rapid changes. There have been a lot more of the downside risks of our economy, and we are under huge pressure. I hope that both the FS and his colleagues involved in such work will be responsive to the calls of the public, that is, would like to have more relief measures. On this occasion, the government is amending the bill so that the tax reduction rate will be enhanced to 100%, and the government is relying on CSAs to introduce the measure. I hope the government will implement it as early as possible. With the further tax reduction, it means that employees may not have to pay any tax at all. For the grassroots working class, with the growing pressure, I think it is still a piece of good news, even though we may only be talking about a saving of a few hundred dollars. It will still be helpful. Mr. President, regarding such measures, I'm afraid only those who are chargeable to tax will benefit. But what about those who are not really paying any taxes as a result of low income levels or owing to one reason or other? They would then not be benefiting from the tax concession measure. So I would like to ask the administration to come up with other concession measures so that those not benefiting from the tax concession in this exercise can still be given some assistance. So I speak, thank you, Mr. President. We'll resume at 5:15 after the suspension.